So I was rejected by all but one college, and the college that accepted me, it was out of Atlanta. I don't remember the name. It was 1975. Anyway, they sent me a letter that I had been accepted and offered me the scholarship, and I was like, oh my gosh, finally I'm gonna amount to something. Somebody thinks that I'm valuable in this world. So excited, so enthralled with the idea I'm actually gonna have that opportunity to be a fashion designer. Ran in to tell my home ec teacher, showed her the letter, and she looked at me like I was so pathetic. Aww. And she said, Marie, you'll never be a designer. You just don't have any talent.
Yo, what? So we're live. Marie P. Anderson, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you for acknowledging my P and Marie P.
With professionally over four decades, yes. You've been doing this your entire life.
Yes.
It was an easy decision to ask you to come on and speak about your experience within the modeling industry from a variety of roles. You've done it all. Mm-hmm. And usually all the guests, I kind of just order it in a chronological order from how you first came into the industry, how you became aware of it, what was appealing to you at the time. So things like that. If you can kind of like rewind the clock and take us back, I think that's a good place to start.
Okay. 6 years old.
Oh, wow. Okay. Let's do it.
6 years old, Cocoa Beach, Florida.
Yeah.
My mother, before I was way born, all of my siblings were born. My mother had been a model.
Oh,
and
okay.
Before she even met my dad. So the point being is that you flash forward. So now I'm a kid and we're in Cocoa Beach, Florida. And my father was a rocket scientist at NASA during the Apollo Moon program. What was my mom going to do?
Sure.
And so she was a community activist.
Okay.
And she was doing fundraisers for various things in the neighborhood, and those fundraisers were always what we now call runway shows. They were called style shows back then.
Oh.
But now they're called runway. So she was making all these runway shows to generate sales, and then I was one of the little models walking down the runway. So cute, like doing a little bikini number.
Were you having the best time at that age?
At that age, you're
probably not keen on too much of the behind, like the numbers behind everything, right? And it's just like you get to try on different fits and stuff and just do your thing, right?
It was, I don't remember exactly as a child, like what my emotions were. I just remember thinking, here's a cause, we need to step up, and my position is being a little model.
To be aware of that, though, that's pretty cool.
Well, with my mom,
yeah.
She was very much about making sure everybody involved knew their roles, their responsibility. But when I look at the Super 8 black and white video, I could see I was terrified.
You got to get that on Instagram somehow. get that film footage on.
Okay, and I'll tag you. But that's really how it started.
Really?
And she also taught me how to sew. She taught me how to sew, how to knit. And so as a result, I became enthralled with the fashion business.
Okay.
At that age where I was making all my baby doll clothes, then I got more sophisticated when I had Barbie.
Sure.
And then I was then producing my own runway shows in my bedroom. And I only really had one audience member, and that was Ken. I really wasn't into Ken dolls. So, you know, somehow he ended up in my toy box. But anyway, the point was I was all about the girls and the makeup and the clothes and the runway shows. So that really is how it started off. And I was so enamored with the fashion industry. And keep in mind, this was the late 60s into the early 70s.
Sure.
Who was talking about fashion back? You know what I mean? Like, please. So the point is that that's really how it all got started, was with my mother introducing me.
Did you stick with modeling throughout high school?
Yes. Okay. As a matter of fact, and this is one of my heartbreaking stories, but it was a really good life lesson. So I had always wanted to be a clothing designer.
Okay.
That ever since, you know, I started working with my baby dolls and then my Barbies, and then I was making my own clothes. Mm-hmm. I was part of the fashion club at high school. Mm. Like, I was doing anything. Again, it wasn't like we had Instagram or TikTok.
No.
Or we had nothing back then. And so I would reach out and connect with anything that I could to get me closer to that goal of being a clothing designer. And then when I think I was in my senior year, you know, you start applying for college scholarships and stuff.
Yeah.
So I was rejected by all but one college. And the college that accepted me, it was out of Atlanta. I don't remember the name. It was 1975. Anyway, they sent me a letter that I had been accepted and offered me the scholarship. And I was like, oh my gosh, finally I'm going to amount to something. Somebody thinks that I'm valuable in this world. So excited, so enthralled with the idea I'm actually going to have that opportunity to be a fashion designer. Ran in to tell my home ec teacher, showed her the letter, and she looked at me like I was so pathetic. Aww. And she said, Marie, you'll never be a designer. You just don't have any talent.
Yo, what?
I gave it up right there.
Oh.
Because I believed in her opinion of me.
Yeah.
More than I believed in my opinion of me.
Well, what were the immediate effects of that? How were you consoled? How did you turn that around?
Well, I turned that around. Another part around that same time, I had tried to become a professional model, and I give that little quotes, air quotes. And I went into the only agent of the time. It was in a shopping mall, Merritt Island, Florida, the Merritt Square Mall. And I wore the only nice dress I had that my mother, and oh, by the way, I was married. In high school.
Whoa, okay. Well, yeah.
I've had a very unorthodox life. But anyway, so I wore the only nice dress that I had that my mother-in-law had bought me for our homecoming dinner, and mustered up all the courage I could to go meet the agent. She didn't even allow me to sit. I just stood in front of her desk, and she looked me up and down. She goes, you'll never be a model. You're way too tall. I was only 5'8". Then I shot up the next year to 5'9". And she said, besides, nobody's going to hire a model with green skin. I have Cherokee blood in my background. And so during the summer, when I go out in the sun, I get very brown. And that brown is more like an olive.
Hmm.
And so I stood in front of her, a suntan teenager, and she was criticizing the color of my skin.
From the very get-go.
Yes! 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 So I didn't walk out of her office. I dropped like a little slithering. I just dropped and I kind of just slithered through the door. And those two experiences eventually, it wasn't right away, but eventually I would come to learn in adulthood that there are a lot of people in the position of power that don't know what they're doing, and they might have some mental health issues of their own, and as a result, they can tell you things that can break your heart.
Absolutely.
And break you if you allow them to. And I allowed both of those situations to essentially break the spirit of that endeavor or those endeavors. But I got them back.
Oh, okay.
As you know, obviously, as I got older, the quicker version is, so I would eventually graduate from high school.
Okay.
Wouldn't go to college, would end up, I was 17 when I arrived here, and I got a job working at an employment agency. And then eventually that employment agency, the owner was really more like a godfather than he really was an employer, and which I can get to my darker side of life and how he saved me. But he had hired me as the assistant receptionist. Now, I was just right out of high school. You know, what kind of skills do you have right out of high school in 1976? But I did know how to type. So he hired me as his assistant receptionist. In a couple weeks, I became the only receptionist. Within a year, I was now the office manager. And within two more years, I was now his personal assistant because I was reliable. I followed directions. You know, I didn't have any traditional skills, but I had what he told me. Common sense is a priceless thing to have in a human being. So he said, kid, just listen and do what I tell you to do and everything will be fine. And that's exactly what happened. And as a total of 3 years would pass, he came to me one day. Again, he's like the godfather. He's not a traditional employer. He came to me and he said, Marie, I have a job opening and I want you to go interview for this fashion photographer's studio manager position. I was like, no.
He was willing to give you up?
Yeah. Because I was driving him crazy.
Oh, wait, how so?
Because I would learn and I'd want more. Learn and want more. And at some point, it's like, you're my personal assistant. What else can I give you? It's like, I don't know, but find something else for me. It's like, well, he found something, different career.
Okay.
But again, it was like, you know, talking about God's intervention in things where he literally directed me into a whole nother world that I thought that I had left because of this, my home ec teacher, right? And because obviously I wasn't going to be a model because I was way too tall with green skin. but anyway, so he wanted me to meet with this fashion photographer, Stan Malinowski, who was just a few blocks away from the employment agency. And this is over Division and State on Chicago.
Wow. Okay.
Chicago? What are you saying, Marie? In Chicago on Division and State in River North.
Yeah.
And anyway, I was saying, no, Perry is my boss. I said, no, Perry, I don't want to go interview. He's going to rape me when I walk in the door. He said, kid, shut up. Just get your shit together. What have you learned about being in the employment agency business? Just get the offer. I didn't say you had to take the job. Just go over there and get the offer. I was like, fine. So I dressed myself all up thinking I was all snazzy. I was pretty cute back then. And anyway, I walked into his studio, again in air quotes, but it was really his home because he had a little studio downstairs. And as soon as I walked in, I knew I belonged there.
Oh, wow.
And Stan didn't want an interview with me because I didn't have any skills other than working at the employment agency. But my boss, Perry, convinced him to interview me because I was way mature beyond my years. And as soon as Stan and I started talking, he offered me the job right there.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, it was just like, you know where you belong.
Yeah.
And when you're in that environment, like, okay, yeah, this belongs to me.
I can imagine those first years back in the industry were very formative.
Oh my goodness.
Like you said, you walked in, you had that sense of belonging. What were some key takeaways from coming back, from getting back into the industry? I guess this is your first time in the industry,
professionally.
Right? Professionally, yeah. What did he teach
this,
you?
It was just so life-changing and so empowering.
What was the role of the studio? Like, what were you tasked with?
Anything and everything you could possibly imagine. There was a donut store on the corner of State and Division, and I lived over on Dearborn. And so every morning I would go and get him a donut.
Oh.
And then I would go to his home, and I would make an espresso, and he taught me. Everything was very high-end.
Sure.
So he taught me how to use the espresso machine and exactly, you know, very OCD. Everything had to be posh and perfect. And so he taught me about my eye for beauty, my eye for luxe brands, my eye for detail in everything that I did. Everything is important. Every detail is important, whether people think so or not. It was important to him. But everything from making his coffee in the morning to I would pick up his dry cleaning, then I would be on the phone with one of the agencies in New York, booking a model for the cover of Vogue that we were going to go to New York and shoot, to talking with Stan about the models that we were going to book for our trip to Rome, shooting the Italian collections.
Did you ever feel like you were above that role of getting dry cleaning and grabbing the donuts, making the espresso?
No, it never occurred to me, because just like my mom had taught me when I was younger, this is the role. This is what you, this is what needs to happen in order for us to accomplish our goals. And so with Stan, it didn't even occur to me that that was below me, because it was an opportunity for me to be in the industry that I had only kind of heard about, because again, we didn't have social media. Entertainment industry wasn't on the TV like we know it to be now.
Yeah.
Excuse me. So
it was that much more valuable to have that much insight into through that person, through Stan.
I was in a world that people only dream about. And I would find myself back in this era that I'm referring to in the early 80s, I would find myself in Rome with Stan shooting the Italian collections for all the designers. And I would be in literally Valentino himself in his atelier with all the top models on set. And I'd just be watching these, they were creatures. They were just so flawless in how they moved together and individually. They were like just watching swans or something. It was just, I can't even articulate what a magical, ethereal experience it was. And then here's the designer, Valentino, and it was couture. Everything was the best of the best of the best. And I was just standing there like, you know, a little beach girl, you know, just going, whoa, this is really where I am. But damn it, this is really where I am. And this is where I should have been.
Interesting.
Had I not listened to those naysayers early in my life.
Right.
So that's the quick version. So Stan.
Amazing.
When working for the Italian collections, my eye got trained.
So that is something you can train.
Oh, absolutely.
Did you feel you had a natural like proclivity to it?
Yes, because I had been trained by the best there was, Stan Malinowski.
Before that, did you feel like you had a natural?
No.
Interesting.
No.
Okay.
Back in those days, our American beauty consumption was blonde-haired, blue-eyed models. And there was, as a general rule, there was really nothing called exotic. And so that's a whole nother conversation of how John Casablancas came into America and created the model wars between Eileen Ford and then him having Elite. Then he brought in all these darker beauties. And so because I had been working with that type of darker beauty, more exotic beauty in Rome, that's how my eye got trained for a different type of beauty. Not that there's anything wrong with blonde, blue-eyed. It was just different.
Sure.
And it was more inclusive.
Sure.
And so when I would return to Chicago, that would then influence when I would cast for whatever we were doing, Sears for a week or something, like whatever catalog we were working on back at the time.
Yeah.
Because back in the day in the 80s, Chicago was the largest fashion catalog manufacturing market in the country.
Sears was huge.
Sears, Montgomery Ward.
Rest in peace.
Yes. Montgomery Ward, like Evans Furs, Carson Perry Scott.
I mean,
we just had...
We
just had so many clients and so much money was being spent, which is a whole nother conversation in that we didn't have really what is now what we know to be called editorial. Okay. So much of fashion back in that day was shot on a white Cyke.
Okay.
So, you know, you didn't have them rolling around in the surf.
Okay.
You know, wearing.
When you say white Cyke, is just that white backdrop?
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
With the curved.
Gotcha. Gotcha. Gotcha.
So they, it was just, you know, you churn and burn like tons and tons of photos throughout the day because you were just shooting a white background and they could drop in copy. And that was catalog. It was easy peasy. But I was wanting to book the darker girls in those catalogs instead of only the blonde haired, blue eyed.
What an education to apprentice. Not a lot of, you don't, these days, you don't find a lot of like, we talked about this earlier in the car. It's like life, you don't climb a ladder anymore. You kind of just bounce from one job to another. And I think the best way to gain mastery of something is to find someone to apprentice under.
100%.
And just thinking about that aspect, like of you know, casting and thinking about who's going to be looking at these catalogs and just having that awareness of marketing, right? Without any formal education. And that'll lead to your decisions of who to cast.
Absolutely. And I inherited that from Stan. And it wasn't like brainwashing where I thought he was nuts, but I was doing it anyway.
Yeah.
You know, like, oh, I'm going to do it just because he's my boss. Like, no. Like, I really dug the darker, more exotic women.
Okay. Okay. Okay.
Professionally speaking.
Yeah. And at what point did you feel like you were ready to step out on your own?
Well, it's interesting you should say that because it wasn't my idea. It was Stan's again. I'm telling you, I have had.
You're just surrounded by nice, encouraging people.
I know. I have been very blessed in my life. I can assure you that I really do believe.
And you're paying it forward.
Yes.
That's the thing, right?
That brings us to a whole nother conversation I'm sure we'll get into. And as a result of being gifted those life transforming opportunities, I understand the significance of that power.
Yeah.
Just like I understood the significance of the power of those two women when I was a teenager shutting me down.
It can go both ways.
So as an agent, when I eventually did become an agent, and I'll still answer the question about it, I took those lessons so that with every human being that I came in contact with, I was vicariously trying to mend my broken heart by every person treating them with respect.
Absolutely.
And so that hopefully then they would pay it forward to treat other people with respect. But going back to how I transitioned then into becoming an agent, so I had been working for Stan maybe 3.5 years. I get a little fuzzy on because it was so long ago. But
that is a long time to apprentice.
He came to me one day and he said, "Marie, I think you should become an agent." I'm like, "Really? Why?" He goes, "Because you're spending way too much time with the models when they come over for their castings. And I'm not paying you to develop models. Clearly, you found a passion. And I think that that's what you should go and do."
So as a studio manager, you had the opportunity to taste test a variety of roles within the modeling industry. And he saw something in that. He's like, "You're gravitating towards the models."
Exactly. Okay. No longer, like, he bought me expensive equipment. He taught me how to be a photographer.
Oh,
like,
okay.
Anything and everything you can possibly imagine. Anything he had, he gifted to me as an opportunity to kind of find my way in life. Like, where was I drawn towards? And clearly it was with the models.
Okay.
And photography in general.
So what does that mean next? Like, can someone be an independent agent, or are you opening up your own agency, or like, how does that work?
Yeah. Now, to clarify, the culture that we're in now, in the culture that you know, with social media and the internet, is drastically different from where it used to be.
Mm-hmm.
Back in the day, when you were working inside of an agency, there was a true rite of passage that the owner or manager, whoever it was, would put you through in order for you to learn the business. Because it was such, was, is such an incredibly responsible role. Mm. Because when you take on a model and you sign a contract with them, you're accountable.
What does that mean, cannibal?
Accountable.
Oh, accountable.
Yeah, not a cannibal, okay, but accountable. Okay. You should be accountable,
yeah,
meaning that you are now responsible for this human's career.
Okay, okay.
That is a big deal.
Okay.
There's a lot of people in this world that don't see that necessarily as their job. Sure. Like, oh, you know, I'll sign the contract. We'll get them on the website. That's another conversation.
Do models have managers as well? Is it separate? Kind of like, yeah, actors, actresses, right?
All the above.
I grew up watching Entourage. I loved Entourage. Okay. So like Ari Gold kind of like is that for me. But yeah, I mean, so the agent maybe didn't see that in themselves as a responsibility. They're like, well, that's a manager's role.
Well, it's more like they're really not passionate about their career, but I'm taking a paycheck and I'm going to cool parties and I work for an awesome brand. Like, they're not being accountable to their own employers.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, it's more of a job for them.
Yeah, it's not a passion. It's not a career. But which leads me to, so when there I was being Stan Malinowski's studio manager, he suggests I become an agent. My favorite agent at the time, her name is Jane Stewart. She had a boutique agency called, then it was called Stewart Talent. And so I called Jane and I said, I want to become an agent. I want to work for you. And because I had already been booking her models, she said, when do you want to start?
That helps.
And so she knew my pedigree coming from Europe and New York. And so I was bringing something to the equation. Not only did her agency not have, the city did not have. So I knew I could dominate as an agent because I knew what was coming because I was working in Europe and America, and as a general rule, America would be slow to eventually catch up with what was happening in Europe.
Sure.
So I had already been there. I knew where we were going. So anyway, it was working for Jane Stewart. I think it was like maybe a 400 square foot office. Mm. And I'm not making fun. I'm just stating fact that our composites were in plastic potato bins. Like, it was a really like low budget kind of successful agency where there was nothing posh about it.
Sure, sure.
But our brand outside was posh because the quality of the models and we were making money and stuff. But anyway, I started working for her. And within a few months of working for Jane Stewart as the woman's booker, I was also interviewing this makeup artist, George Statner, one day. And as I was flipping through his book, he wanted to become represented by the agency for his makeup and hair. And so that was the reason for the interview. And because I booked them as well as the female models. And I was going through his book and I found this beautiful, exotic young teen with a beauty mark. And I said, oh my gosh, who is that? He goes, oh, her name's Cynthia Crawford.
Where did this come across? Like, where? How did you?
He's in his. See, back in the day, you had a portfolio that was a book.
Okay.
And you would have prints, and those prints would be in plastic sleeves.
Okay.
And so I was turning the pages of the book of George.
Because you just hear people being out in public and being discovered. So, but she was in a book. Okay. So
yeah.
She was trying. She was going for it.
In theory. So. I find her and he says, oh, her name is Cynthia Crawford. She's just a high school girl. She's already been rejected by the agency, so she's not interested in modeling. I'm like, you need to help me find her. Scott Weimer was the photographer who shot the images. And so between Scott and George, they arranged for me to have a conversation with her. And then first I had to talk. First, I had to convince her that I was even, okay, I'm legit. I'm not going to waste your time because she lived in DeKalb.
Yeah.
And there was construction going on. So it would take
her,
to come all the way downtown Chicago And I would come to learn, like, she was a straight A student and wow. like a whole different level.
Went to Northwestern for like a short period of time.
But we didn't know that yet. Yep. She was 16 at
right,
the time.
Right.
So anyway, first I had to talk to her and her mom, and then her parents were divorced. Then we had to have another meeting, her mom and her dad. And then the decision was, okay, we'll start.
Yeah.
And it wasn't overnight success because remember,
did someone tell her? Because she was rejected, right?
Yes, because of the beauty mark, and she had dark circles underneath her eyes. And if you don't know how to light, then a girl does have dark circles
sure.
under.
Sure, yeah.
But if you know how to light, she's got no problem underneath. It's the photographer's lighting that's wrong, not
right,
the girl's
right.
face.
Right. So is that what you told her? Like, what else did you tell her to kind of turn her perspective around, to light her up? Get her back on board.
Just that, trust me, I know what I'm doing. Okay. I have come from Europe and New York. Like, this is the direction that we're going in our culture, that more women like you will be embraced. And back then, she was round. I mean, not that she isn't still shapely now, but she was considered, quote unquote, heavier relative to the skinny blonde girls.
Sure.
She had shape.
Yeah.
And I was assuring her, you'll be fine. You'll be fine. We will find your market. We will find. I promise you.
Right.
So in the very beginning, it wasn't an overnight success, but then there was a photographer, Bob Frame, who had shot her, another photographer, rest his soul, Victor Skrzybniewski, that took her under his wing. And then as soon as Victor started shooting her...
He passed away not too long ago either.
Correct.
Yeah, okay.
So as soon as Victor started shooting who became Cindy, not Cynthia anymore. As soon as Victor started shooting Cindy, then everybody else was like, oh, now, right? And then eventually she became a huge success.
Did anything change in society or culture that made her more appealing at that point? Like, what was it?
I think a lot had to do with more John Casablancas bringing in more exotic beauties from Europe. And then also scouting those exotic beauties as well as blonde girls, but integrating a more diverse type of beauty into our American culture.
What was their motivation to do that, to bring more of a variety?
Because he was smart and he knew it was the thing to do. And there was beauty that was being ignored by the world. I mean, not in Europe, but
here,
in America.
Right? And at what point it's more racially inclusive, but now it seems like it's all types of inclusive.
You can thank
height to
social
shape
media
to,
for that.
Oh, okay. So I was going to ask, at what point, so in 90s or midnight, early 2000s, when that shifted or when generally it became more inclusive?
I would say social media was a massive influence in that because, I mean, I don't want to give you a long lecture on the modeling industry because I know so much and it's very complicated. It's not like I can make one statement and it encompasses everything. However, John bringing that kind of diversity and with him, with all of his panache and press and parties, and it was... a breath of fresh air.
Okay.
And it was hip and it was new. It was innovative. It was modern.
Yeah.
And everybody just kind of got on board with that.
Okay.
And right around Cindy's time, there was a super successful, exquisite model by the name of Gia.
Oh.
And Gia, unfortunately, would die with AIDS as a result of her heroin addiction. And so Gia, with her dark beauty, was kind of like, boom, this is the idea of our new culture in America. So she dies. And then Cindy was kind of like the baby Gia.
Hmm.
And so she kind of use that as a kind of a
catalyst.
Not her literally, but the agency used that as kind of like the platform to then escalate her even higher.
Okay.
Escalate her career.
So at this point, I mean, do you just grow as an agent? Like, you're just looking for other models at this point? Like, how are you growing yourself at this point after Cindy or with Cindy, you know?
So a few months after starting, no, within a year of my starting with Jane Stewart, mm-hmm. she came to me with this idea of becoming a business partner with John Casablancas and turning the fashion component of Stewart Talent into Elite Chicago. And I said, it is genius. Absolutely do it. I've been booking his girls. They're amazing.
But like, so with someone that absorbs the overseeing company, like, are you get their resources? Like, how
yes.
does that?
Okay. Okay. So this is all very important to yeah. my little story here. So Jane Stewart merges with John Casablancas. Sure. The fashion department becomes Elite Chicago. Mm-hmm. We move from the little 400 square foot office with the plastic potato bins as mm-hmm. the composites, move over to 212 West Superior into this gorgeous loft. Are you old enough to know what a chia pet is?
Yeah.
Okay.
Chia.
Yeah. So we went from being like this quiet, awesome agency that was successful. It was like overnight when we became Elite, it was like adding water to a chia pet. We just exploded with success. Because again, now Jane was bringing into Chicago what Chicago had never had. Mm-hmm, and that's mm-hmm. in alignment with a New York agency. Mm-hmm. And not just like, oh yeah, we'll send you models. It's more like, no. We believe so much in Stewart Talent that we've now merged with them.
Mm.
And that just gives you a brand name, a worldwide brand name that you cannot contest.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
And so I went from being the director, I went from being the women's booker to the director to the vice president.
That's wild.
And that was over the course of 7 years.
That's a long time.
Yeah.
What?
That doesn't have a happy end, but.
Right. And at the time, within that 7 years, for the most part, was it very fulfilling to have that role?
It was amazing in the sense of the freedom and the power that having the Elite name gave to us. I had already had it because I could talk anybody into anything because of where I had just come from. And mm-hmm. nobody in America, including the majority of the agents, had my experience. Mm. They might have worked in America, but they weren't working in couture over in Europe with designers. Right. So I could do anything I wanted just at Stewart Talent. But as soon as you mention Elite, all of a sudden, you know, you can say, hi, it's Marie from Elite Chicago. Oh, what can I do for you?
Wow.
All of a sudden, it's like anything and everything is at your doorstep.
So what type of clients now were at your doorstep now that you had this new, you know, opportunity?
It's hard to even articulate because...
Like, did you think this is it? Like, you're at the peak of the mountaintop, right?
Yes. And what was really interesting, like we were talking about in your Jeep, we were talking about culture.
Yeah.
And with all that awesomeness that came our way, it also created... Well, how do I explain? I think people are really who they are anyway, but it enhanced gossipy, snide, backstabbing culture in the agency in Chicago. And then I was having to contend with that same kind of backstabbing hostility in New York. And so it's a trade-off. Mm. You know, you become more successful, more powerful, and that gives you a lot of freedom. But at the same time, you know, when Elite New York is trying to look down their nose at me, like you're just this little peon from Chicago, I'm like,
From within their own company? Like, that's yes. so crazy.
Yes. Ego.
Was there, and this is coming from the very top, or was there people above them that was coming from the top?
Mm-hmm. Because it's like, oh, no. How dare you think that you're as important as we are? Mm-mm-mm. You are not an equal. Okay? You're in Chicago. We're in New York.
That's crazy.
Yeah. Don't even get me started.
So how, I mean, you put up with that to a certain, you know, extent. Mm-hmm. And then what?
Well, the unhappy ending to all that was the crescendo through that as the years passed and more of my models would become part of the elite network, specifically the females were my lane, which they still are. I was, part of my job was to essentially just produce models for the network, right? So you'd start them in Chicago, get them kind of seasoned, and then get them off to Europe.
Gotcha.
And then my models eventually would come home communicating sexual harassment, sexual assault of John's business partner. His name is Gerald Marie. And so, and now we're in the mid-80s into later 80s. We, as a culture, really weren't talking about rape. And we, you know, you really didn't say, oh, that photographer touched me inappropriately. I don't want to work for him anymore. Back then, it was like, oh, well, if he touched, and I'm not speaking for this as my response. I'm talking about the culture in general. So, oh, if a photographer touched you inappropriately, just tell him not to do that. And, you know, you're going to be booked there next week anyway. Like, completely dismissing their human rights and their boundaries as a human being, and essentially teaching models that it's all part of the business. Oh, if he wants to sleep with you, just sleep with him. It's really not, this is not me. Mm-hmm. But this was the message mm-hmm. that we were giving our models. So when models were coming back to me complaining of these issues with him specifically, and then I would try to talk to Jane about it, but I couldn't divulge who had said it because my models had sworn me to secrecy. And still to this day, I've not compromise their confidentiality. If they come forward and talk about it, that's their story. But I was coming to Jane, and Jane's like, Marie, he's in Europe, you know, we're in Chicago. It was awkward. Like, what do you, we just didn't have the education back then. Yeah. We didn't know how to have that conversation, employee to business owner, talking about girls that I couldn't tell her who they were, and like just having this
I guess
vague chat.
Would you do anything differently now? Like, how would you navigate that conversation now?
That's like completely different. And that experience changed completely how I agented, in the sense that once I started seeing that the culture in the business, and it wasn't just elite, it was pretty much any agency, had this reputation of, you know, they're going to hit on you, just go along with it kind of thing. Accept it. So anyway, the point is that when I was getting multiple people saying the same thing about the same man inside of our network, then I stopped sending my models. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. I just found different markets to avoid that situation. And so this is almost coming to a crescendo. So I started to live in a solution and not drinking the Kool-Aid, so to speak, of the corporate life. And then it was like, I think it was late 1989 that I was in Ibiza, Spain. We were there on a corporate summit. All the elite hierarchy were there for many days, strategizing our corporation and getting better in sales and blah, blah, blah. And I didn't mean to, but I overheard a conversation between Gerald Marie, John Casablancas, and two female New York elite staff members that were head of the New Faces. And both the women were crying and pleading John and Gerald to stop sleeping with the 13 and 14-year-old girls.
Oh, my God.
And I'm now listening. Like, it was one thing for the models to come and tell me about what had happened with them over in Paris, but now I'm actually hearing the source talk. talking about it, Wizards of Gerald, and then John Casablancas defending himself also for doing the same thing. It was like, just, I was just so heartbroken and disgusted and saddened. I, even at that time, had already been a sexual assault survivor myself, and to hear the owners and our culture, the people who dictates our culture, to dismiss this as this is just kind of men's play, so to speak, that this is just the way it is, I had to quit.
Yeah.
And I did quit. And yeah, so that was late 1989.
Wow.
So it was the first time I quit. Actually, I tried quitting a couple other times, but Jane,
she kept.
Yes, I swear to you. I think with Jane, I quit two other times. She would bring me back. And then it was that last time I remember that she said, Marie, I don't have any other job for you. And I don't plan on retiring anytime soon. Mm-hmm. So I understand if you got to go, you got to go. And so I swore off the agency business. I said, if this is what being an agent is all about, is essentially producing, well, what we know now to be called human trafficking.
Yeah.
So I'm now a human trafficker. No, I'm not going to do that.
Now, did you ever feel any sense of guilt for leaving the models to just kind of fend for themselves? Or?
Yes. I felt tremendous guilt for doing that. And yet, again, we didn't talk about this kind of stuff back then like we are now. So I myself had not had enough recovery in that area. So there I was trying to do what I could, being a victim, a survivor myself, with really not having the tools, the emotional tools or the intellectual tools to try to make a difference.
Yeah.
But I knew that staying was part of the problem because I had the power to make things happen. And I was that person that was essentially funneling.
Yeah.
So to me, my solution was just to quit. And so I did. And I had I don't know if we're going to go into like other decades, but yeah. So I quit that time. Another time.
Well, what was next for you?
So,
I know you're a second degree black belt, and like that can be a separate episode, but like what was next for you essentially?
So I swore off the agency business and I opened up this little company called Model Futures, which was a model coaching, career coaching company.
Okay.
And scouting.
Okay.
So I would be scouting models and then placing them with various agencies. And I had one of my clients was an agency owner who was paying me to teach her about the fashion business. She had a very successful commercial agency called Mary Boncher Model and Talent.
Hmm.
And she and I were having lunch one day. Now, this is 2 years after I left Elite. We were having lunch one day and she said, you know, obviously you bring so much value into an agency. I've really been thinking about bringing in a partner to create a new agency. And I was like, I really do miss the agency business so much. I miss the girls. I miss the community. I miss the camaraderie because I was working alone, you know, and again, this is before cell phones. This is before anything.
Yeah.
Back in 1990 to 92. And that's how my agency Aria was born. So Mary Boncher Model and Talent ceased to exist. I brought in the fashion brand. We called it Aria. We were over at 1017 West Washington, which the only thing that was over there at that time was Harpo Studios.
West Loop, right?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
What we know to be called the West Loop.
Right.
We couldn't even get cabs to go over there. It was such a downtrodden neighborhood.
Very industrial. Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
But a lot of abandoned buildings.
Sure.
So there was Harpo across the street, and then there was Wishbone Restaurant.
Harpo, is that Oprah's?
Yes.
Oh, okay, yes. Okay.
Which has since come and gone.
And then Wishbone, oh my God. I saw Wishbone the other day. I'm like, it's just bare bones now. It's so sad.
Yeah, I don't know if that was by choice or what the deal is.
I mean, their other location's killing it right now, so Yeah.
So we were very progressive in opening up Aria. Yeah, and yeah. I told Mary the only way I'll go back into the agency business is that nobody is molesting my models. Nobody is hitting on them. Nobody is intimidating them. Nobody is bullying them. She's like, no. My core values are just like yours. I'm a Christian woman. I would not let that happen to any of our models. So we opened up Aria Model and Talent Management in January of 1992. And man, we were an immediate success. It was insane. It was so wonderful.
What were the initial clients with Aria? Was it more catalogs? Was it
everything? Was it clothing companies? We had an on-camera department. We had lifestyle, commercial print, and we had fashion.
Wow.
And Mary, the bookers call it, I think it was Black Monday, because I was going to start, and coming into the agency, I was going to essentially dictate the models that we were going to terminate, because I didn't think that they were fashion models. And this is just a cute story about success. So I was telling Mary, like, this is the list of the girls I'm going to terminate. That girl, she's short and she's too large chested. She'll never do fashion. Again, this is before social media. So anyway, her name is Meredith. And Mary said, you can terminate any of these other girls. Do not terminate Meredith. You haven't even met her yet. I promise you. You have to meet with her. And if after you meet with her, if you don't think that she's got it, then we'll let her go. Okay, fine. Bring Meredith into the agency, and I explain, you're a little on the smaller, I think she's all 5'5", 5'6". I said, you're on the smaller side. You know, if you're interested in acting, I can, start you off modeling, but, you know, we really need to get into acting. And she was just such a dynamic human being. She sold me. I'm like, I can't believe that I'm going to keep this shorter.
How much of modeling is then personality?
Oh, like 99.9% personality. I can't tell you how many models, and still to this day, how many models I've gone into the interview going, no. And then they start talking, and before I realize it, they've convinced me. And I'm like, if they can do that with me, imagine they could do that with sales, you know, selling themselves on when back in the day before COVID, when you actually would go in, a model would go into a physical casting at a studio, she could act, and him too, it wasn't just girls, but you know, you could sell yourself on your personality, and you could be the most beautiful girl in the world. But if you can't carry on a conversation, that's boring. People want to be entertained.
Interesting.
That's just human nature, isn't it?
Yeah.
But Meredith, she said, I'm really only interested in modeling, but I will become an actress if you work with me as a model. So we had this, you know, quid pro quo.
Yeah.
And I can't remember how much time it took, but eventually she landed on a very successful TV series called Dawson's Creek.
No way, really? Mm-hmm. I've never. I know it. I know of it. It's.
And now, if you see some reruns of Dangerous Minds, you'll see her on there.
Oh wow!
So, there's a perfect example of, you know, my world of fashion, and what a fashion model was. But Meredith was working in some of the fashion clients because she also had an athletic body and she could move. And so we found a way to book her in what is considered non-traditional fashion clients. And back in this day, we did not have athleisure. Like the sports world came into the fashion world and invaded the crap out of it. Invaded. So back then, you know, you didn't see all these various fashion brands and these awesome kicks and all sorts of really cool tracksuits. And I really believe, and somebody could challenge me, but I really believe that hip hop music and like MTV drastically influenced the fashion business. Like they brought their culture of athletic wear, like they made it posh. They made, you know, with all their gold chains and making it look much more high end. and before we knew it, and also, God, was the Dapper Dan. Dapper Dan out of Harlem and New York was a drastic influence in bringing in that athletic wear as well. Like, it was more like streetwear becoming hip and part of the fashion world. So anyway, the point being, bodies did change as a result of the fashion industry changing.
Interesting. Interesting.
Or the acceptance of different body types. And when you had cultural influences like Jennifer, J-Lo, right?
Yeah.
Jennifer Lopez, shorter, rounder, larger, curved rear end. I'm not a big fan of hers, but Kim Kardashian, you know, I mean, shorter, rounder women came in and with their cultural influence drastically influenced our...
People are getting Brazilian butt lifts because of
that. Yes, yes. It's true.
So what was after, how long were you with Aria?
So Aria, that was a huge success. We had that for 13 years. Oh, P.S. And by the way, when I was at Elite Chicago, I wrote my first book that was published worldwide on how to become a model. And Cindy was on the cover of that. And then when I was at Aria, let me see, we had that for, I think it was 10 years. And then we bought out our competitor called Suzanne's A Plus, merged their staff and their models in with our loft across from Oprah. And then in 2003, I think it was, we sold Aria to Ford.
Okay.
New York. And then what was, I quit the business.
What was enticing enough to sell?
Well, it wasn't enticing cause
you,
to me.
Because you're giving up your livelihood. You're giving up your day-to-day, right?
Yeah. So like, I'm giving up like the blood that flows
especially
in my body.
You had ownership, right? So it's just like, How what was that back and forth like?
Well, I had two business partners and they were older. And not that that means that they were ready to go to pasture, but they just were ready to not be in the business. And in order for me to get on board, his name is David. David was our VC. He was our venture capitalist.
Gotcha.
And so he had only been with us for 3 years. And so when Ford came by, a venture capitalist, what are they going to do? Like, they're thinking
money,
right?
I need my money back. Yeah.
So David, knowing my passion for the film industry, as I had mentioned, I really wanted to be John Hughes. And so he said, Marie, if you sell, you can move to LA and finally have that career of producing feature films. I was like, dang. So I talked to my staff, asking them, do you want us to sell? And they're like, yeah, you know, we could be Ford. Like, we had a really awesome company.
Right.
But
right.
Again, when you bring in that New York vibe and that whole global network thing, it's like, oh, okay, you can take something that's really awesome and make it better. Of course they're going to
want that. Did you get flashbacks of things from Elite coming at that time?
Oh God, yeah, but we won't even go there. We don't have enough time for me to complain about that whole transition.
Okay, so now do you go back to school and try to pursue film?
No. You'll get a kick out of this because you're more tech savvy than I am. But so when I was going, this is how naive I was in moving out to LA. So when I was at Columbia College, we learned on this camera called a Bolex.
No.
This is my point. Oh my gosh. So it's a handheld camera and it shoots black and white film. So you'd have to process the film and then you'd have to put it into an editing machine where you actually are touching the film and putting it to an editing machine and you would splice it and take tape and put all by hand, right? And so that was in the 80s. I was going to Columbia College studying film production then with the Bolex camera. Okay. Flash forward to 2004. I moved to LA, get a business partner, attorney, office, equipment, And then I find out everything is electronic and you have to do everything on a computer. I was like, oh my God, this, and then other things happened. I was like, I'm in over my head.
You tried opening a studio, like a production studio?
Oh yeah. Oh, I did.
I did.
I spent all the money to open the office. It was in West Hollywood. And I remember I was sitting, I can't remember his name, John. He was a huge producer. He was involved with, I think one of the Terminators, if I'm not mistaken. Anyway, I have this awesome script and it's about Major Taylor, who's this incredible cyclist. He was the first African-American cyclist in the 20s to ride in the velodromes. And the story of him being raised by white people and then becoming this super athlete and then people trying to beat him up and torture him. Like, it was just, that's, you know, racism. And so he wouldn't be accepted by his people because he was raised by whites. And then he couldn't be accepted by the whites because he was African-American. It's an incredible story if you ever read his story. Anyway, I had that script. And our first meeting with me and my business partner, we're sitting in front of this very established producer, and we're pitching the script, Major Taylor, and, you know, his whole entourage is there in the West Hollywood office. And he says, I can see it now. It's like, I don't know if you're old enough to know the movie Chariots of Fire. Oh, my gosh. Anyway, it's this awesome film about these runners. But, and they're on the beach and it's very epic in how this music and how it's shot of these runners on the beach back in, I don't know if it was 30s or 40s, but anyway, he said, I can see it now. It's like Chariots of Fire on bikes. And he saw this, he got it. He was like, oh, we're going to do this, 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 and this. And I was like, yes, yes, yes. And then he said, wait, who's got the rights to this screenplay? I said, oh, well, it's my friend who wrote it, and he gave it to me. He goes, who's got the rights to the story? Major Taylor, do you have in writing? And I looked at my partner, and he looked at me, and I was like, I'll get back to you.
Yeah.
I was like, I don't belong here.
Oh.
I was in way over my head. I had no idea
With the whole background of being an agent and all that, like navigating all these different types of roles in that industry, like you were pretty prepared.
Well, there's also a footnote to this. I was only 1 year clean and sober.
Oh.
And so finding myself in West Hollywood, working in West Hollywood, living in West Hollywood, only 1 year clean and sober, I was like, I'm going to relapse.
From alcohol?
Alcohol, drugs, cigarettes. You know, there's a long list of addictions. Gotcha. But the point being is that that was all about self-acceptance. 20-year goal, and I get there. And I had to accept the fact, what's more important, trying to prove that I could become a film producer and literally start again and have to fumble my way through, or focus on my sobriety and making my sobriety my priority. And that's what I chose to do. So I left LA after a year and I moved to Scottsdale, where I invested millions because I had made that from the Ford sale, and bought the home of my dreams, spent $150,000 on upgrading furniture, $150,000 in upgrading the house. And then, the housing collapse.
Oh, wow.
Lost everything.
Wow.
Yep. I went from being a millionaire to a pauper in just a couple of weeks. Arizona was hit hardest and first. Like, in a way, it was, to live through that was so traumatic. Living in a gated community where people were literally leaving in the middle of the night, ripping out chandeliers, washing machines, dryers, trying to take anything that they could because their houses were upside down, and then abandoning. So I was living in a community that was this posh community, but now everybody's leaving. People were committing suicide because it was just, as you know, that was a horrible time for our country. having all that just bubble explode. But then, true story, only because I had to, because I had no other way of getting another job. In Scottsdale at the time, there really wasn't any true modeling, although that's changed. It's grown quite beautifully now, but back in then I really didn't have a job that I could go get. So I became a dog walker.
Hmm.
I know nothing about walking dogs. And this woman who hired me, essentially I was her house sitter slash dog sitter. And she knew me, knew I had no idea what I was doing, but she left me with directions. And she had just turned them into vegetarians.
Dogs?
Yes, two vegetarian dogs. And they weren't like little chihuahuas. These were like a massive dogs. And I would be trying to cut their cantaloupe and their beans, and the dogs were standing on their hind legs and slamming my body against the refrigerator because they wanted some freaking meat. And I was like, talking to dogs, like, hey, I don't know what to tell you. I've got your beans coming up here. But this is important because the doggies didn't like me. And so I would start walking them around the lake because this woman has a mini mansion. And so I was walking them along the lake. It's like 120 degrees heat and their leashes. So I'm sweating, of course. So the dogs did not want to listen to me because they knew I was like amateur hour and I had no idea what I was doing, but I was trying. So anyway, the dogs, and this happened day after day after day. So the dogs ran at the same time and they pulled me down. Okay, the leashes are gone. I fall down and my head falls into a pile of dog poop. So my head, my forehead, not my face, but my forehead is now covered in wet dog poop. And I'm crying now. The neighbors are laughing hysterically because amateur hour is trying to take care of these dogs, right? There's a good end to this. So anyway, I stood there crying and I looked up at heaven and I said, I'm done. Whatever you want me to do, I'm going to do it. Just please don't make me a dog walker because this is not my calling. I'll do whatever you want. The neighbors helped me get the dogs, bring them into the house. My cell phone rings. It's one of my models back here in Chicago, Connie DeBee. She says, Marie, I just left Ford. I had it with them. I need you to take my career back. I said, Connie, I've just lost everything with the housing collapse. I've got nothing. She said, I don't care. Come stay in my house rent free, hang out with my dog, drive my car, do whatever you want. I need you to come back.
Wow. Another angel.
It's like crazy, man. Like you would have thought people would say, Marie, she's so old. Leave her in the desert.
Yeah.
Let her just decay.
Wild. The highs are high and the lows are low. That's so interesting. So you came back. You came back. And what was that? Was that a humbling experience? Like, what was that like?
It was like crazy humbling. Because by the time I got back, so that was like late 2008, I think. 2009, somewhere in there.
Yeah.
So then I opened up a new agency inside of Grossman and Jack Talent. That agency was called Agency Galatea.
Mm.
And then I had that for almost 8 years. And then the owner, Linda Jack, decided she didn't want to have the print component, that she just wanted to focus on the voiceover and the on-camera actors. So she terminated Agency Galatea. And then I took a year off. In that time, which we won't get into because it's just such a crazy story, but then I put myself into a rehab facility. And as quickly as I put myself into the rehab facility, I realized that they were crazier than I was. And I was trying to get out within the first 24 hours. They wanted me to have electroconvulsive therapy.
Oh, wow.
Without even giving me a psychological evaluation. And I was at a $3,000 a day facility here in Chicago. This like wasn't some low end, like Cook County. So anyway, the point was, is that like I was trying to do all these things, you know, I've got this time off and trying to figure out what I'm going to do with my life. And that took a year. And then I would be hired by Wilhelmina here in Chicago. And I told you about that. That was not a great experience, although I love the brand. I have multiple models with Wilhelmina. I love it. But the CEO at the time and I did not go get along well together. And I think I lasted at that agency maybe 5 months, five, 6 months. And then kind of shortly after that, they would close the Wilhelmina Chicago office. But it was with that experience I decided to leave the agency business completely. And so for the past 4 years, I have been a model manager, or also called a mother agent.
Okay.
Now, it can be very confusing because an agency can be a mother agent to a model. And there's a different type of career called a mother agent that does not book the models, does not invoice, does not chase after collections. And that's what I am.
Gotcha.
So I place my models.
More of a motherly role.
Yes.
Okay.
And so I will place my models with other agencies.
Gotcha.
And then they will give me a commission.
Oh, okay.
It doesn't come out of the model. It comes from the agency.
But you'll do like coaching sessions too.
Yes. Okay. Oh gosh, yes.
That's great.
Down to what to write in your
bio. So has this been, has this been the most fulfilling part of it then so far?
It all has been fulfilling.
Right. Right. But you have the most control as far as your role right now with your clients. Like you don't feel like you're fueling or funneling into something that you don't believe in.
This is the most, how do I explain this? Because it's very complicated. Either the models accept my philosophy of keeping their clothes on in their photos, not sexually objectifying themselves, not drinking and taking drugs and making a fool out of themselves and posting it on social media, making a fool of me. Like, I am a family-friendly, G-rated brand.
Mm-hmm.
And so either they are that type of a model, that type of a person, then we can work together.
Mm.
If they don't see the importance of integrity and self-respect, then I can't sign them. When you're in an agency, you can't be that discriminating.
Interesting.
It's like, in theory, well, so she's a drug addict, Marie, as long as she can show up on time. It's like, yeah, but if I'm working with her, then aren't I a part of the problem in her addiction? Like, if I'm not helping her get into some kind of a program, whether it be an eating disorder or, you know, drug addiction or alcohol or whatever, like, I need to be part of the solution. So my models know that I manage. Like, if you're heading down that way, I'm not going to just sit back and say, have a good time. I'm not going to terminate their contract. Well, first of all, I wouldn't have signed them if I thought that they were going to be self-sabotaging. But life happens, and you know, we have these experiences and things change. But if I'm managing somebody, they have to be able to meet me halfway with their integrity.
Yeah.
And if I see them compromising themselves and me, I will have those conversations saying, look, you're going down the wrong path. And if you continue to do that, that's your decision, but I can't work with you.
Gotcha.
Whereas being in an agency situation, if somebody's making you money, the owner of the agency would think you were insane for letting that person go.
Right, right.
Right? It's like, what are you talking about? They're making us money. It's like, well, aren't we just exploiting them then?
Mm.
Like, yeah, so, but we're making money. It's like, well, I can't work with the person knowing I'm part of this problem.
Yeah, right? Absolutely. Absolutely.
So I'm a mother agent. I have 13 people. And back about just how people can change your mind. A year ago, I went home to Florida and I was having a family dinner with, and I was meeting my niece's new boyfriend, Gabe, and he's a former Miami Dolphin NFL football player. He's like this literally 6'4", 250 pound human sitting across from me. It's like I'd never in my entire career been interested in managing an athlete like that. They're just walls. Imagine the Rock. Like, they're just, you know, what do you do with them?
So what, that piqued your interest?
So his body size didn't pique my interest. It was, he was just so charming, so handsome, articulate, loving towards my niece. He was just such an all-around amazing human being. I was like, the whole time during dinner, I'm like, don't talk to him. Don't get distracted. You're at a family meal. You're not here scouting. But he was just so delightful. After dinner, I went up to my niece and I go, Bobby, what about making him into a model? And she stepped back and she goes, make him some money. Bobby's mom was my model at Elite Chicago.
Did you know this? Did you know this going into that dinner?
Yeah.
Oh.
So.
Oh no! Sorry, Bobby. Okay, yeah. I'm thinking the guy.
Bobby's a girl.
Yeah. Sorry.
So Lisa is Bobby's mom. So Lisa was my model at Elite Chicago in the 80s.
Oh wow.
So you flash forward all these decades later, I'm sitting having a family dinner, and Bobby, who's in her early 20s, is introducing me to her boyfriend, who's in his later 20s. And so the whole thing is that Bobby knew about Lisa's career. So it wasn't like out of the random suggestion.
Right.
It had been part
of
the family discussion since she was a baby. Anyway, so here we are a year later and I'm managing Gabe.
Oh, really? Oh, that's amazing.
Who I love. I absolutely adore him. I want to say I love you when I'm on the phone. It's like, wait a minute, I shouldn't say that because I'm a manager.
Would you say is 13 the sweet spot? Sweet numbers? Like sweet spot as far as like how much time you get to spend with each client?
When you say is 13 a sweet spot for the total amount of people that I want
per manager or per age? I guess, I'm sure it's a little different.
Yeah, it's very different.
Yeah.
I'm a solo entrepreneur, meaning that nobody is doing any of my anything. I do everything from social media to booking tests to editing the film to introducing them to agencies to taking them out of agencies if it's not working. Now that COVID has passed, you know, submitting them to Europe, figuring out do we suggest South Africa over Milan? Like,
wow.
It's all me.
So, I mean, for you then, do you feel like you would, what's your sweet spot, you know, in this current role?
I'm laughing only because, you know, there's an expression in recovery it's called, when you want to hear God laugh, tell him your plans.
Oh.
Because, you know, as I've already said, all these themes, you know, I've quit the business and I get pulled back in, quit the business, get pulled back in. And every time I say, okay, I'm not going to manage anybody else. That's it. I'm done. Nobody more contracts. Oh, my God. Then somebody else is somewhere. Because they're personalities.
It's you too, though.
What you mean?
Hmm? It's you too. It's your personality. People enjoy your company too.
Well, thank you. There's just I know it sounds cheesy, but there's just such a soul connection. And if I feel that with somebody, it's like having that Barbie. And I want to play with them. Mm-hmm, I don't want to send them back.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I want to be able to be part of their lives and to be able to empower them to reach their dreams.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Let's pivot to how has social media impacted this industry?
It's
pros and cons, right?
It's flipped the script in a way that I can't. You essentially grew up with it.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And so me, I had to learn about a smartphone. Like, I didn't pop out of the womb and there was the iPhone in my hand. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I'm 63. So I had to learn all about, you know, the technology between the laptop and the iPhone and connected and AirDrop and the cloud. And so it wasn't just social media, it was technology in general. And with social media, and it's interesting because I'm going to sound like I'm going to slam it, but social media is And specifically Instagram, not literally, but Instagram has become the new portfolio in that that's what clients will stalk to see the truth. Like they can see the agency portfolio. Oh, she's so perfect. She's so this or he's so that. But then it's like, those are just flat photos. You go to the Instagram and all of a sudden now you're seeing the person. Who is this person? What makes them interesting? What's their story? Why should I book them when I can book 100 other blonde-haired, blue-eyed girls, right? So Instagram becomes that immediate market research. So in that sense, I think it's good in that clients, agents, we all can go right to that Instagram and immediately find out, who is this person really?
Sure.
Whereas before social media, you couldn't do that. Before social media, the agencies pretty much had all the power. Like the photographers, hairdressers, makeup artists, models, everything went through the agency. We were the power holders. We were the traffic controllers. We would decide which photographer works with which model, which hair and makeup, right? That was our job. And if we were doing it right, we were making sure we were elevating careers with every decision. What happened with social media is that completely, so if you can remember, or not remember, but if you can think of the agency as most people being at the bottom of a pyramid, and then the agencies being at the top, the apex. Well, as a result of social media, it's completely broke down that apex and flattened it. So now everybody has access to anybody that they want. There's no power brokers anymore. And it's complicated, but I'm making a very general statement.
Yeah.
Where now if you, now you can't control how they respond, but let's say that you wanted to reach out to the brand Gucci in Italy, you could send them a DM, right? If you were a model, photographer, whatever, that's it, boom, instant contact. There's no more mystery or, oh my gosh, I'm waiting for somebody to do something for me. You make it happen for yourself. That's unbelievable power in your hands.
Yeah.
And yet at the same time, there's a whole lot of responsibility in having that access, because once you have it, do you know what you're doing with it? Like now that you've gotten their attention, are you ready to step up into that responsible role to be the model, to be the photographer or whomever? You know, so it's like giving power to people, which is really amazing. But yet at the same time, if they don't know what they're doing, they can make a fool of themselves. They can also become part of an organization that are sex traffickers without even real, you know what I mean?
So is that a large part of your role right now, is kind of like helping people curate their portfolio?
Absolutely. Right? That's one of the things I love to, I travel the country doing a lot of public speaking. And although that they don't realize it, it's kind of like taking some sugar with medicine. I'm talking to them about social media, but really what I'm talking to them about is integrity.
Mm-hmm.
And some core values as human beings, and who do you want to be?
Mm-hmm.
What are you going to put up with? You shouldn't have to put up with anything.
Mm.
You know, sexual harassment, agency extortion, stealing your money. Like, the list is long. There's a lot of shady people in this business. And now with Instagram, heck, I was cloned 3 different times.
I saw that.
3 times. They took my exact...
They
did, Instagram.
And then they even cultivate a following, and they add all your followers, and then they start sending weird messages to your followers and like, give me money or whatever.
The only reason that I knew is because people were either calling me or DMing me saying, are you asking for my phone number and my home address and my credit card? Thankfully, people, because of my brand,
oh, right.
People knew. It's like, this doesn't sound like Marie.
No.
So thankfully. But yeah, so the point is that, you know, that's the thing about social media, is that when you've got some super tech savvy people, they can take your, well, thankfully it wasn't hacked. It wasn't taken from me. And then extorted, as I understand. I talked to people who...
I know a few people that...
Yeah, it's like, give me $10,000.
Instagram won't even give it back to them. It's really weird.
Yeah, it's like the victim has no rights. It's the, you know, the bad person is the one who's in the power. But anyway, the point is back to Instagram is like, it's just kind of like the modeling business. Nobody's really running the show. Instagram isn't.
Yeah.
You know, they don't, they're not concerned about the, well, I'm making a blanket statement because that's contrary to what I watched the owner talking about. He's talking about all the time about mental health and safety is so important. It's like, well, if it's so damn important, why didn't you take 3 clones down of my account? Because what you do when you go to complain, they you have to fill out this form and you've got to take a photograph of your driver's license the day of that you're reporting it, right? So I was doing that and I was sending it to Instagram. Then it was saying, you're not fulfilling your responsibility of the person complaining. It's my account.
Yeah.
I've just shown you my driver's license.
What more do you know? Yeah, it's like...
So anyway, back to... That's the con part of it.
Can you kind of share your experience on like what social media has done to create mental health issues within teenagers and just people in general with body dysmorphia and just like not living up to society's expectations or standards that maybe companies have promoted through media? And over time, it's become more inclusive, right? And to learn how to love yourself. But then you have, I heard a clip from Jordan Peterson the other day, how he came out on Twitter, because Sports Illustrated featured a plus-size model on their cover, and he was critical of it, and he was like, this isn't a healthy lifestyle. It's one thing to accept this body for yourself and come to terms with it, but to share that someone of that size is the pinnacle of like a healthy lifestyle would be a lie. And he got a lot of criticism.
I was just going to say, I didn't know about that. Thank you for telling me about that. But I can only imagine he got some backlash.
So much. And it's interesting. It's just like, I think there's a right and wrong. It's how you navigate that conversation. And it's how do you promote self-love while also trying to promote a healthy lifestyle?
I do that every day for myself. I try to do that every day with my models. Social media, what I try to explain to them is, you know, at the core of who you are, what are your values? Something I've been noticing, and this comes back to what you were just asking about, something I've been noticing and has been breaking my heart this year, if you scroll through Instagram, look at how many shots are of young teenagers with their butts at the camera.
They know angles, posing, just to promote different curves.
Why do I need to see your butt?
Yeah.
Yes, there are clients out there. That's what digitals are for. And the digitals are part of the model's portfolio. A girl does not need to constantly be posing one post after another of her butt in the camera. Like, we don't need that. What are we telling our models? Another one that drives me crazy is open crotch at the camera.
Yeah.
Why do I need to see that girl's crotch? Really? Like, and why are we unzipping pants? Why do we need to unzip pants? Because it's suggesting, to me, it's suggesting either you've just had sex or you're about to have sex. But these kids are seeing all this constantly on social media, open crotches, butt at camera, unzipped jeans. This is what being a model means. It's like, no, it doesn't. Oh, the other one that's driving me crazy is the underboob. So you will have a crop top that is just covering the nipples, and then, you know, the underboob. Agencies post underboob shots, open crotches, unzipped pants, butts at the camera.
Agencies will?
Oh, God, yeah. Go on the agency's website. So this is what I'm getting at about, you know, like there's nobody running the show. See, back in the day, you know, in the early part of modeling, everything had to be perfect. The nails had to be painted. The makeup had to be perfect. There was no such thing as digital photography or Photoshop.
Mm.
You had to shoot it right the first time. The model had to show up, not with chipped nail polish and mascara underneath her eyes hungover. Like, you had to be healthy and show up looking like a polished model. Nowadays, and I talk to photographers all the time, I talk to other agents, models will show up on set with chipped nail polish, dirty hair, whatever, and then they'll say, well, the photographer can just Photoshop that. Not even taking into account, like, number one, you're not being a pro by showing up in a hygienic way, but two, being so disrespectful towards the photographer that now you're going to make him sit, or her, sit for hours in front of a monitor to fix your lazy ass because you didn't want to get your manicure done or wash your hair. I mean, like, there used to be such a quality and such an aspirational professionalism. And now with social media,
does that make it back to the agency? Like why would an agency cut that person after hearing about that? And
well,
like,
you brought up a good point in that now with the social media influencers,
because of their following and the engagement that they have on their page, they have more leverage. Mm-hmm. Gotcha.
Back, I remember when Instagram started, and I was guilty of this. When Instagram started, people would call and say, oh, you know, I've got 1,000 followers on Instagram. I'm an Instagram model. I'd be like, yeah, whatever, Instagram, whatever. Like, yeah. I didn't care about Instagram, and I didn't care about your Instagram following. But now, you know, I eat my words, you know, because I had no clue what was going to happen with social media. And yet at the same time, she'll admit this story. So I was one of my favorite people that I manage. Her name is Haley. And when I was interviewing Haley at Agency Galatea, she was 15 going on 16. And I think at that time, and she's now, what, 22? Something like that. Sorry, Haley, I forgot how old you are. She's about to have her second baby. So she's like grown woman. So 15 going on 16. I think she had like 350,000 followers on her YouTube channel.
Wow.
So I'm interviewing her at Agency Galatea, and I said, well, if you've got all these hundreds of thousands of followers on YouTube, what are you doing in front of me? Like, you've got it. And she goes, no, I want to be legit. I said, oh, well, I can do that. So I signed her on the spot because of her personality and her beauty. But the point is that at the end of the day, as much as the social media influencers have that leverage, there's still this psychological unspoken, well, you're really not a model.
You're an IG model.
Yeah. You're an Instagram. You know, come on. You did that. And we don't even know if those are legit. You probably bought those followers. You know what I mean? So we could talk about that, you know, till the cows come home. But social media has completely flipped the script on the power dynamic, and it has given people power to do whatever they want. The sad thing about the industry, well, there's a lot of sad things, but one of the sad things about the industry that I have to contend with on a daily basis is that as a result of so few clients left in the fashion business and the industry being so saturated between traditional fashion models and social media influencers, that making a general statement, most agents, I don't know if they would be public with this, they don't have the time to develop. So it rests on the model's shoulders to do the developing, meaning that they would have to know how to get their hair cut, color of
you're,
the hair.
You're saying that the agents don't have enough time to spend with the models?
Absolutely.
Oh, okay.
That's how mother agents, there's so many mother agents in the world right now that aren't inside of an agency. Why is that? Because the agencies don't have the time to develop. So a lot of those agencies rely on the scouts and the external mother agents to do the developing. So when somebody like me will call or send an email, they know that that model is already going to have their digitals, already going to have at least one amazing test, like, so that they can look at the model and go, oh, okay, we can start representing them now. Mm. Because the work has been done, the fundamentals.
Mm. Interesting.
So the art, there are lots of great agents out there around the world that still do the book development, but there's not an abundance of them like there used to be.
So are the clients more so for editorials now? The ones that don't like really don't want to reach out to or don't want to utilize the social media influencers?
I can't say it's interesting it in a when black you say, and white statement.
Yeah, it's interesting when you say it because there's still something that's legit about going through an agency. It's interesting.
But I think it's so hysterical when I see so many of these social media influencers in their bio, it will say agency represented. It's like, that's my badge. Like, now I'm legit because now I have an agency.
Or they'll tag the agency.
Yeah, but the point is that if you are so much in command as a social media influencer, why do you need to say agency represented? You would just have mother agent with that agency.
It's a verification badge.
Yes.
Yeah.
Instead of a blue check mark.
Yeah. Yeah, right. So if someone's trying to get into the industry, what questions should they, or what type of agents or mother agents should they be looking for, and what types of questions should they ask them to find a right fit?
Well, I've got a couple quick answers. One is there's a really awesome book that they should read to help address that. And it's called, I think it's called The Model Manifesto. And it's written by a beautiful blonde model from London. You can get it off of Amazon for under $20. So full of good information, just talking about how to prepare yourself for a modeling career working with an agency. So that's a good book to read. Also, if you go to YouTube to my company's channel, Boss Babe Models channel, not to be confused with all the other Boss Babe channels that are out there. It's got to be Boss Babe Models, plural.
Mm-hmm.
I've got free video advice in there. Like, I'm talking about one in particular is like how to handle a receptionist at an agency. You know, what color nail polish you should be wearing. Like, just the basics.
That's wild.
So there are some very practical ways. There's a lot of information that's available out there that is legit information where they can get all those questions answered really quickly.
And now, you know, with social media, is it overall more inclusive in general? Maybe that'll depend on the niche that they're trying to model for, but in general, have you seen more inclusivity in the industry for models?
There's been a drastic change. Absolutely. I'd say the last 2 to 3 years.
Because we're bringing it full circle, right? Because you saw that beauty mark on Cindy, right? So it kind of brings it full circle, like seeing potential that no one else sees,
mm-hmm.
right? Are you still noticing that?
Well, when you talk about inclusivity, what's running through my mind is Tyra Banks several years ago choosing Winnie Harlow. She's got vitiligo.
Okay.
So she has two different color skin. Like,
yeah.
Before that, you would never see a model with that.
Interesting.
And now you see them all over the place.
Yeah.
So to me, that's very inclusive. You now see all sorts of models that have Down syndrome or that are transgendered.
Mm.
So there's really drastic changes, I think, in really good ways with the industry embracing truth. This is the reality. These are human beings that should be respected and be honored, just like the tall, skinny 5'9" or 5'10" traditional fashion models.
In high school, I worked in the back of Hollister.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
Have you seen the documentary that just came out recently?
No, I gotta. But I feel like they made a comeback? Because they're more inclusive these days, and they've kind of pivoted.
I can't answer that. Watch the documentary, because at the end of the documentary, I was kind of left with, and now.
Oh, okay.
But yet,
because I feel like it was hard to find kind of larger sizes. It had like extra small, and then it was like kind of hard to find.
Well, the whole brand, and that's what the documentary is about. The whole brand was so racist, sexist, exploitive. Bruce Weber being, even back then, being known for being an alleged predator. And he was the one that they kept booking to shoot because his images are exceptional. You know, it's like if you have models coming to you complaining about somebody being a predator, alleging these things, and you're continuing to book that photographer, what are you telling the rest of the world?
Yeah.
You're just empowering that to keep happening.
When you know better, you should do better.
Thank you.
Right.
And so Hollister had a lot of racial issues.
I didn't even know about. Yeah, I didn't even know.
Oh my gosh. I think it was an Amerasian class action lawsuit because they didn't want to have ugly people. Like they had photographs of how you would cast the employees. And there was an African-American woman, really beautiful African-American woman, who they would only, she was a staff member or whatever. And they would bring her in only to work the closing shift. And the closing shift was the janitorial shift.
Yeah. I mean, I definitely didn't feel good enough to work in the front. I worked in the, I prefer the back anyway, but like, yeah, I felt that when I was there, and it was just a winter job. Otherwise I was at the golf club doing golf club things. But
well, I think if you see this, yeah. Unfortunately, they were not unique, I guess is what I'm trying to say, why I bring it up. And it was like, yeah, that's the business. Yes, that's the business.
Okay.
But they got into trouble for it. And I was, I went to go meet some friends the other night at a local bar, I think it's called Sparrow over in River North. And over on, I think it's State and Elm. Yeah, it's State and Elm. There's a new Hollister store.
Oh, wow. I wouldn't have ever thought to have a Hollister store on the streets. It's usually in a mall.
So it's right there, and it's beautiful.
Wow.
Beautiful, modern. I was like, wait, what? That doesn't look like the end of the documentaries. So I was like, and because we know what's happened with COVID and the violence in Chicago and specifically River North and like Burberry's being attacked with burglaries and like all the stores have suffered from it. You go down State Street and you'll see so many stores that are vacant or so many storefronts that are vacant as a result of COVID and longtime businesses going out of business. And then you've got this beautiful brand new Hollister store. So maybe they know something we don't know. But as I understand, by the end of this year, we're not supposed to be in great financial position. Yeah. So more will be revealed.
Especially because you had an interest in clothing and designers. Any thoughts on like fast fashion, like Zara, H&M, and like, do you lean more towards clients that like, do you think about that? Like when you send models to potential clients, like what does this client represent in general?
I think in the back of my mind, I'm thinking about so many documentaries where I've watched all that fast fashion stack up in deprived countries, and it's destroying the earth, our planet Earth, the water, the actual land. So yes, that runs through my mind. And yet at the end of the day, sadly, if that model wants to take that booking, knowing that that client is doing what they're doing with their fast fashion, that's their prerogative. If I stood up against every single fashion brand that was destroying the planet, I don't think I'd have many models working. Unfortunately.
Yeah. It's
for me, my activism is centered around mental health and safety of models because of so much abuse that goes on, verbal abuse, a lack of financial transparency with the models, essentially extorting their money.
Should they be paying to become part of an agency or like to get bookings? Like,
not, well, let's clarify paying.
Please, yeah.
Let's clarify paying. So for all the novice listeners, when you are represented by a legitimate modeling agency like a Wilhelmina or a Ford or whatever, you will be on their website, and each modeling agency charges something to be on their website.
Okay.
Whether it be $100 or $600, there's a price.
Is it per month or per year?
It just depends. Oh. It just, each agency is a little different in how they pitch that. Oh, it's only $12 a month. When you multiply that towards times 12, you know it's going to be over $100. And then some of them say it's per year. But at the end of the day, each agency has a website, and then they will charge the models. 99.9% of the legit agencies will charge something. That is not to be confused with what I hear often. Yes, we will represent you, but you have to pay us up front for us to represent you, to put you on our website, meaning to manage or to book you. It's very, very different. You're not paying for the website fees and the management of the company that charges the agency, passing down the cost from the booking system or whatever. They're charging you just to be part of the agency. So I know it's a fine line, but no, a model should not pay an agency to represent them, but understand that a model will spend money to be on the agency's website.
It's similar to like someone's Instagram feed. It's just like you're paying to live on someone's real estate, which is their website.
Exactly.
Interesting. How do you draw that fine line? Where, like, how do you discern that as the model?
Call me.
Ooh, okay.
Girls, I charge. My time is not free. I am $250 an hour for my coaching. But seriously, all joking aside, if somebody says, we'll bring up a specific agency that I know is doing that, meaning charging them just to represent them, I will be honest with that particular model.
Now,
they asked.
Let's say everything's legit and you pay the fees to live on their website. How often or how much of are the gigs can you expect from a potential gig?
I can't answer
what,
that.
Is there a range?
No, not anymore. Not with COVID.
Oh.
COVID nearly decimated our industry. 2 years of not literally being inert, but 2 years of very little happening and a lot of companies going out of business.
Oh.
So it just depends now. And social media, back to Instagram, so many clients not wanting to spend an agency fee. And I'll give you an example, and I'm just pulling this out of my hat. Going back to my point, and my point is that a lot of clients don't want to pay an agency fee, and a lot of clients don't know the difference between a professional experience model or an Instagrammer who's a social media influencer. Like, they don't know who's actually going to be able to perform on set. They can't discern.
Sure.
It's like an athlete. Like, you see one guy throwing a football, it's like, oh, he threw a few yards, that's a good football player. And then you see, you know, professional football player throwing, it's like, oh, it's way over the goal. It's like, yeah, but they're still both passing the ball. So I'll take the one that's cheaper, who's cheaper. So many clients go to Instagram and will book that influencer or whatever you want to call them and say, so I'll pay you $1,000 for the day.
Which is more money than they'd probably ever seen.
I'll pay you $1,000 for a day. I'm a new cosmetic line. And we will shoot you. You're going to be all over our website. We're going to have posters of you in whatever shopping malls are left. We're going to do banners.
And if that influencer doesn't want to do it, another one will.
Mm-hmm. Whereas the agency would say, cosmetic line, $1,000. Oh, no, 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 no. You're going to spend thousands of dollars because we don't want our model associated with your brand. If it's a low-end brand, we want our models to be bougie, right? We want them to have luxe branding affiliated with them. So if all you're offering is $1,000, we're not going to take that. Go back to Instagram, because we're going to charge many thousands of dollars, and we're going to put a 20% agency fee on top of that invoice.
Mm.
So let's just say not a high-end company, but it's still a good brand. They might get paid $35,000 for the year.
Wow. The model.
The model through an agency.
That's just one client.
Yeah.
On average, how many clients would a model get?
It just depends. It depends
like
on...
Like in the dozens range or in the hundreds range?
Sweetheart, it's...
That's crazy.
I don't mean to
be
vague.
Good for them. I mean, no, that's great. Okay.
I don't mean to be vague. It's just that nowadays things are so very different. And what constitutes a client now? There's so many like jewelry designers, and I'm not making fun of jewelry designers. I'm just saying as an example, I can't tell you how many jewelry designers I know that only book through Instagram because they can, you'll tell a girl, oh, I'll pay you $50 for the day and then I'll give you some earrings. That little teenager is like, oh my gosh, $50, that's so much money. And I get some earrings. Oh my gosh. You know, they feel like Cindy Crawford because it's all relative.
Right.
Whereas the agency will be like, no, 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 you're not. We won't even book you for $50 an hour, let alone $50 for the day. You know what I mean? Like you have value as a model in an agency, and we're going to make sure that you don't get devalued by accepting bookings that are low end bookings paying you crap rates. You're a great model. You should be paid accordingly.
Now, when you first start out, how do you derive how much value you're providing for that client?
The agency. Well, if you're with a legit agency, the agency will tell you.
Yeah. Does that just come with experience?
Yeah. I'm an experienced agent who will know what the market will bear.
Because same. I mean, as an Instagram influencer, I think there's a learning curve to like how much value you are providing for certain companies. And you are probably undervaluing yourself in the beginning. And especially if you are providing good quality work, hopefully if you ever, some people don't even have contracts, right? It's just like after the deed is done, you know, if they come back, then you would like up your commission a little, you know? It's interesting. I think it's a lot of hit and miss, and then eventually you hit.
Yeah.
And
then they start to get a clue.
But that's the benefit of having someone who's been in the industry, right? Wow, that's crazy. And as a model, is there a limited window of opportunity to be a model? Because on your website, you have a variety of age ranges, right? Mm-hmm. But before that, it's just like, oh, you have from a certain amount of time to be a model, and then what do you do after that? But is it a little different now?
20 years ago, oh. But it doesn't apply anymore.
Wow.
And clarify, the industry as a whole, like for example, one of my former models from the 80s, Claudia, she just did a campaign for Clarins.
Mm.
She's got a full head of gray hair. And she did a global campaign for Clarins. And it ain't the 80s, and she's not a teenager. You know what I mean? So the point is that gray hair, it doesn't matter. And Clarins, it doesn't matter anymore.
Can you elaborate what Clarins is?
Oh, sorry. It's a skincare line.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Like,
okay.
It's really nice.
So then with,
social media. Do you think agency life is ever going to have a comeback, or like, is it going to, you know, what do you think the outlook is?
I talk to agents all the time, and
are they worried?
Yes, everybody is. Well, again, I'm going to get in so much trouble saying the truth, but the truth is everybody is worried, because all these very experienced agents who knew before social media how much clients spent, when we had actual a lot of clients that spent money, and then before COVID, and now here we are, COVID, the industry is saturated. I can't, even in the city of Chicago, I'll be on Instagram and I'll like, wait, what? Who is that? They're an agency? I'm like, who's, but what? Oh my God. Like, I don't even know who 3/4 of the agencies are. And not to make fun, but it's like, where did you get your education to make yourself an agent? Mm. Oh, I'm sorry. So your sister was a model in Japan in the 80s. And so now you're becoming an agency owner. Like, it's just sad that the industry has become so saturated, and the quality of the care of the human beings, meaning the models, has dropped considerably.
It's interesting because the demand to become a model is still there. I mean, especially with social media, it looks appealing when you get to go to these parties or go on a boat, uh-huh, and eat fancy food and just be just spoiled, right? And
glamorous.
It seems very glamorous. And it's just, I don't think they know what they're getting themselves into.
There is a trade-off. There is a trade-off. And for me, I have been where I don't want them to go, in many, many areas of the business, meaning that there are many unsafe environments. And if anybody is in denial of that, I say watch a documentary on Harvey Weinstein, on Jeffrey Epstein, on Ghislaine. Like, pay attention and watch these documentaries. And R. Kelly.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Yeah, you're
Hugh Hefner. All these allegations have come out.
You're intoxicated with, there's like a haze, right? You're like the allure, the power, mm-hmm, and the luxury that you've probably didn't experience prior to that. And you don't, it's hard to lose something once you have it, mm-hmm, right? And you have it now. And when you come face to face with how ugly the truth might be, mm-hmm, it's like, ooh, can I live with this?
It's hard. It's really, really hard. And that also applies to agents working inside of environments where they realize now they're inside this incredibly toxic environment, and I'm making, you know, good money, and I'm going to these parties and going on to these yachts and being fabulous and having more followers on Instagram.
And at the same time, if you truly cared about your models, you're at a crossroads.
Yeah. It's a conflict. Nothing about it is easy. You have to live with yourself.
Ooh.
And what are you willing to give up?
Your soul.
Yeah. Thank you. I swear to you, I was having a very heated conversation with an incredibly talented photographer here in Chicago who's since moved to New York. I won't mention his name. But I was talking about the unzipped pants and the open crotches, and he was like, Marie, come on, that's just considered fashion. It's editorial. It's the way the business is. He said, sex sells, accept it. And I said, it sells the soul. You accept it. Hmm. So we just had to agree to disagree because he was young, right out of Columbia College, really hadn't really experienced much in the business world. And what's so heartbreaking is that you can, and I'm making a very generalized statement, but one example is you can tell a model he's a sexual predator.
Yeah.
And you are guaranteed to have some kind of very unhappy experience if you go to that hotel room. Many times when I've had these conversations, regardless of gender, they will say, but can I get booked on covers?
They're willing to sell themselves.
Yes, it'll be like, it's just sex.
Models have said that?
Yes. Oh. It's just sex. Or, you know, I'll give him a BJ, right?
No
or
way.
Yeah. What? Like, I don't have to, like, ooh, have intercourse, right? I could just, yeah.
Ooh.
It's like, oh, my God. But when they have that hallucinogenic where it really won't happen to them. It'll happen to other people, but it won't. It's delusional thinking.
Yeah.
It's like, no. It's going to happen. Maybe not the first night, but guaranteed the second night, because all they're doing is grooming you, preparing you for what they eventually want.
What if you had a conversation with them about what it could feel like once they get that cover? What, if it's like that, it's not really, like, it's huge, right? But like,
I've actually had a conversation with one of my, going back to the 80s, with one of the models who had come back from Paris, telling me her stories of woe and swore me to secrecy. That was during a lunch that she divulged everything. She had called me from Paris crying, telling me about the allegations about Gerald Marie. And I said, don't do it. Let me just place you with another agency, I promise you. So what you have is and this was before, obviously, cell phones and social media. So, you know, your ability to communicate with the outside world was very limited to an expensive long-distance phone call. So now you're in debt to the agency because they've advanced you your apartment. They've advanced you your airfare. So you are literally in debt.
On their dime.
Yeah, you're literally in debt to that agency. And the owner is essentially, you know, sleep with me and the debt goes away. Sleep with me and I'll give you covers of magazines. So anyway, this one particular model had called me crying. I said, don't do it. I promise you, you're so awesome. You're so beautiful. You don't have to compromise yourself. I'm going to put you with another agency, blah, blah. She's like, you're right. I won't do it. Let me see if I can find another way to kind of maneuver around him. Okay, fine. So that was like late fall. She comes home for Christmas and she's showing me her portfolio that are full of covers. And I'm like, I am so proud of you. Look at what you've accomplished and you didn't sleep with him. I told you. She goes, no, I did. And as soon as I did, I was starting to book these covers. Mm. And now she knows I would never divulge her name. Just this year, because I had been on 60 Minutes Australia and she had seen the episode where I told this story, but I didn't give her name. And she messaged me talking about the shame and the misery attached to those covers. Because once you get older and you start realizing what you did give up, there are consequences, there's side effects to those choices. And in the beginning, it's like, oh, well, it's just sex. It's like, no, actually, you just violated your central nervous system. Mm-hmm. You completely compromised your soul. You know, you devalued. And that sends you into a whole different spiral of mental health issues. Yeah. And back to mental health issues, I don't know how much longer we've got left, but remember I was telling you when I left Wilhelmina, I put myself into rehab. It was for my eating disorder, my body dysmorphia. And the first 24 hours I was there, and they had taken my glasses, long story, but they took my glasses, they take everything from you, and they had lost my glasses, and I can't see without my glasses. Everything looks like wax paper to me. So I was in this one lodge. There were, I think, like 50 girls in this lodge. And I was like the one of three adults. Everybody else were like under 18. That's how many girls there were with eating disorders in mm-hmm. this specific lodge. I thought that they were all wearing sweaters, right? And then a sweater, and I was like, wow, that's really weird. We're in the middle of summer and they're wearing sweaters, but it's like, okay, maybe that's a thing here in this rehab facility. I don't know. I got my glasses on. They weren't sweaters. Those were cutting marks. They had cut themselves so much. It was all over their arms, all over their legs. Mm. And they had to walk around with shorts and tank tops because the facility wanted to see if they were, they wanted to watch for blood to make sure that they hadn't been cutting again. So this is just one lodge of 50 girls, what, 46 or 47 girls under the age of 18, just one lodge of girls with eating disorders. That's what our teens are doing. Like, that's what our culture has done to our teens. Mm-hmm. Is mm-hmm. And I don't even want to go off on rehab facilities being like puppy mills, but it was just heartbreaking for me to see so many young, beautiful women taking razor blades to their bodies because they could not emotionally cope with whatever traumas they had experienced prior to being in rehab.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. You also mentioned you're trying to, you're doing some work with suicide prevention.
Yes.
Can you share a little more
about
that? Yes,
please. Thank you. So I won't mention the agency, but as of about 6 weeks ago, there was somebody in the business who shot herself. And she made the 29th person in my bubble, my life bubble, that had made that decision. And as soon as I heard about that, I was like, I've got to do something. Instead of talking about doing something someday with suicide prevention, now there's 29 people within my life bubble that have all killed themselves. I have to do something. So that's why I started working on a suicide prevention video short. Mm. And I've got an awesome director whose background is in, although he's done feature films, he's done, his real niche is music videos. So he can tell a story quickly and visually beautifully. And that's why I chose him. And he and I actually went to Columbia College together.
Oh, nice, nice. Okay.
So we have that working for me. But remember, I was telling you, tell God, if you want to hear God laugh, tell him your plans. So the way I work now in life is like I pay attention to the flow of things. Hmm. And if I'm running up against a brick wall, that for me is like my way of, okay, that's not for me. So let me try it some other way. So I did this email blast to my entire 6,000 contacts in my email. And my thought was, if I get nobody to respond to the email of my asking if anybody's interested in offering hope to people in misery contemplating suicide, if I don't get anybody back who wants to help donate $50, and I thought, well, if I could get 300 people out of thousands of emails to spend $50, then I can make the $15,000.
That's the budget?
Yeah, that's my budget. It's going to be super low budget, 5-minute film short. So anyway, I thought, okay, that's going to be my my test, my market research. And I thought, if I don't get anybody responding back, then I guess then this project isn't for me, and I'll wait a little longer and I'll do something else. But I have had such an outpouring of people saying, Marie, of course, $50, of course. What do you want, Venmo, Zelle? Like, and it's like, I'm like, oh my gosh. Like tears of joy of people like, this is so important, Marie. Yes, please. If anybody's going to do this, you're going to do this. Do I have a title? No, because my director and I haven't gotten to that point, because essentially he said, you get the money and then come back and we'll talk. But in the meantime, we're still talking about the visuals and the music and the concept and the story. So that's kind of a long...
And it's in general, not just modeling industry?
Correct.
Interesting.
Now, coincidentally, though, there's, from those 29 people, only 4 are not in the business.
Oh, wow.
That's a lot of people. One person is too many.
How many of those 29 shared that they were experiencing issues with suicidal ideations or depression and mental health issues?
Very few.
Oh. So most of them come so suddenly and it's like it's a shock.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I tried the first time when I was 16.
Oh, yeah?
And I still apologize to my best friend since first grade. Her name is Janet. I was taking pills because at 16, without going down a bunny rabbit hole, by the time I was 16, I had experienced so much trauma, heartache and misery, physical violence, sexual violence, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, I had just had enough. I was hopeless, and I started taking pills. I had this massive bottle of pain pills I was taking with a big pitcher of beer, and I didn't think anybody was going to come look for me, and my girlfriend came to look for me, and she would not let me keep taking the pills, and then she made me puke. And that was when I was 16, and I guess my point in bringing this up is that I know what it feels like to be at that point of so full of misery and feeling no hope whatsoever that it's time for me just to leave and to not be concerned about anybody that I would leave behind, because it didn't even occur to me that anybody would care. Mm-hmm. Because I felt so alone. But clearly my best friend, she was upset enough not to allow me to do it. But still to this day, I apologize to her for giving her that traumatic experience. You know what that would be like your best friend that you've loved since you were in first grade is now trying to kill themselves. It's like I put a lot of responsibility on her shoulders, but she's tenacious. She's a Taurus. She wouldn't take no for an answer. And I was scared of her. I was like, okay, I'll stop. Well,
and so that begs the next question. It's just like, if you do know someone experiencing suicidal ideations, what do you tell them? What do you do? It's an emergency, right?
Yes, so like, what do you do? And I'll tell you what I had done with my second attempt. And this is, I think, a funny story. It's sick, dark humor, but still I find it funny. Because if you can understand. So when I was told you I had lost all that money in Scottsdale, and I had just no more modeling business. My whole identity was gone. All my money was gone. Everything was just gone. And by then I had, I think, 3 or 4 years of sobriety, which is important. So I'm in my garage in my brand new Mercedes, and the door is down, the engine is running, and I'm listening to this really incredible classical music. And I was like, to myself, I was thinking, all I have to do is just sit here and allow the exhaust to take over. And what a delightful way to leave. And again, being so full of misery and being so hopeless and thinking that nobody was gonna care. I really didn't think so. Now, intellectually, yes, but at that moment crisis, I didn't think anybody would care. And I'm sitting there and I was like, maybe I should call my sponsor to tell her what I'm doing. Yeah, let me do that. So I called my sponsor from inside the car. She starts laughing. She goes, Marie, turn off the car, open the door. Okay, now I want you to get outside of the car because of what might have been inside. Okay, now, 20 minutes, I want you to meet me at this meeting. It was a very common meeting that we would meet at. So I go to the meeting. And I'm telling we affectionately call in the world of 12-step, telling on yourself, like you just did something and completely self-destructive, but I got to get it out.
Sure.
So that I won't live in that shame. So I'm telling the story. Everybody in the room is dying laughing. And I'm like, what is so funny about me trying to kill myself? There's a guy who jumped into the conversation. He goes, it wasn't funny you were trying to kill yourself. It was how you were trying to kill yourself. Because with emissions now, the worst thing you could have done is just give yourself brain damage.
Oh, no.
That's why they were laughing. It's like, do you even, you know, you would have taken yourself from one misery to another misery. Oh. And you wouldn't have accomplished your goal. You wouldn't be dead. You'd just be like without brain cells.
Yeah.
So anyway, that's what... To answer your question, when somebody's at that moment of crisis, pick up the freaking phone and call somebody or text somebody. There's all sorts of helplines now, not only phone calling, but you can text anonymously with all sorts of counselors.
If you really wanted to kill yourself, you know that people are going to sway you from doing that.
Yeah, because if you have those few seconds that you can maybe I don't want to do this. Maybe I'm just so unhappy and I don't think anybody cares. Let me talk to somebody that might care and try to talk me through this.
Yeah.
Because at the end of the day, and everybody is different, but at the end of the day, I believe in a higher power. And if you can at least hold on to that higher power and know something better is going to come, just hang in there.
Mm-hmm.
Is that the answer for everybody? No. But that's what I hope will be my message, is that I will offer inspiration, because my video short is going to be about me and my life.
Mm.
Because when you think about it, now that we sat and we've had this whole conversation, can you imagine if Janet hadn't intervened when I was 16, Cindy Crawford, maybe she would have become that chemical engineer. Wow. And look how she changed the business worldwide. I've written multiple books that have been published worldwide on how to become a model. I received letters from around the world, people thanking me for empowering them with the basic information so that they wouldn't be taken advantage of. My agency, Aria, I changed people's lives. People still tell me to this day how much they loved Aria. You know, right? So if you don't give up, you never know, something really good could be.
So on the other end, if you were tasked as the person to
excuse me,
to intervene in someone's crisis of experiencing suicidal ideations, what do? Do you walk them through all the possible scenarios and the ripple effects that they may have on other people? Over and over explain like how much people actually do care and what do you...
I think every situation is different.
Yeah.
And in an ideal world, they would be able to talk to a professional who knows how to navigate that. But I have been on the phone with people who are literally about to shoot themselves or cut themselves.
So that's another thing. To be a stranger, and you don't even have face-to-face, like personal, like you can't see things, right? Mm-hmm. So are there generic, like that obviously works, like to have a hotline. So what does a suicide hotline kind of walk them through?
I will hopefully give those answers in the video. You just gave me a great idea.
Great. Oh, okay. Yeah. We're looking for, I'm personally looking forward to that video, but I guess naturally I was, as a paramedic, you respond to these situations.
Yeah.
And as someone who doesn't have any experience with that person who's experienced, I'm not their friend. I'm not their family member. I don't know who you are. And it's hard to say the right things, right. To help them. Cause you want them to come compliantly into the ambulance rather than physical or chemically restraining them.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just like, how do you build that foundation of rapport to have them eventually seek the help that they need? So that, I guess, but yeah.
I think, and every situation is different, but for sure, I would expect in your situation, or hope in your situation that you could look them in the eyes and let them know it's going to be okay. I got you. I got you. I'm right here. I got you. We're in this together. You're not alone. And that's so much of the suicide is feeling alone and lost and hopeless and not knowing what the next thing is to do because you're without resources. Yeah. But we thankfully, thank God, in 2022, we have plenty of resources.
Yeah.
But I think that human connection and just reassuring them that you're there with them, you're not going to abandon them, that they're going to be okay, but they're going to have to do some work. And sometimes it's not just being sweet. You know, sometimes it's like, hey, mofo, sit your ass down, get that out of your hand. You know what I mean?
Right, you have to
be very assertive and kind of shock their nervous system. Like, oh, okay.
Because no one else cared to do that. So that, yeah. Okay. I understand that. Okay.
So it's such a, each situation is unique.
Absolutely.
And you brought up a good point because a lot of it is drug induced. Alcohol induced.
Oh yeah, it's a combination, right?
Yeah, so it's not like you're dealing with just somebody who's despondent. You're dealing with somebody who's despondent and also on mood altering
under the influence
drugs.
Of something, yeah. Right. Okay. Yeah. Well, believe it or not, Marie, we're at 2:30. So
shut the front door. Oh my gosh! No wonder I'm tired.
No, that's how these conversations go. It's just tangent after tangent. It's great. Thank you so much for coming on. It was pretty insightful. I have no background in modeling or the industry, but I was curious enough to have you on. And I guess one more question is like, if you were anything else besides a model, like hair, makeup, or photographer, like, I mean, these days maybe you just DM a model, but like, do you go through an agency or can you be repped by an agency as a photographer or hair makeup artist, or how does that work?
Yes, you can be rep. There is tons of agencies, even here in Chicago, that rep photographers. Back in the day, there used to be photo reps that's all they did was rep photographers and nothing else. Excuse me. And some of those still exist. But for a lot of photographers, they're either A, freelance and have like the studio manager that kind of handles their social media, that kind of becomes like their marketing tool, or they have an agency that reps them and handles all of that. So yes, ideally, if you have a great agent and they can take away all the marketing and negotiations and just take a commission for the booking, that's ideal.
But okay.
That doesn't always happen.
To tie one last thread full circle, you said, you know, tell God your plans and he'll laugh in your face kind of thing.
Yeah.
I read a quote that struck a chord with me the other day, and it was like plans are nothing, but planning is everything.
I like that. I've never heard it before.
Yeah.
Thank you for sharing.
Yeah, no, I'm stoked for your video. It's obvious that people want that video from you. I'm sure it'll be a fun process to produce it. Keep us posted. Where can people find you if you're interested in people finding you?
What do you think would be the safest information? DM on Instagram, you think?
I think so.
Yeah. So my accurate Instagram handle is Marie P. Anderson Official.
That was new, right? You added the official.
I added the official because what they were doing, the three clones, they were just messing up the spelling of my last name.
Do you have the blue check yet?
No. What? People keep asking me that. You try to talk to Instagram and tell them.
You need to submit proof that you're a public official. Like, kind of, you know, like you've been published before, and like your name is easily searchable on Google. So like,
I have incredible.
You're an author.
Yes, I'm an incredible. I have an incredible footprint, but that's apparently not good enough for Instagram. One of my former models' moms said that she's going to make it her project to get me a blue check mark. Swear to God, I was talking to one of the guys at the gym, whose best friend just got a blue check on Instagram. And that best friend told my buddy at the gym, it's not about really being a valid person in the media. It's who you know inside of Instagram.
Oh, good God. Do I really want to know?
It's like, oh, man, that's just like buying followers. You know, that's crap.
All right. Thank you guys for tuning in if you stay tuned. But we'll see you in the next one. Thanks, Marie.
My pleasure. Peace out, homies.